Good morning, everyone. Today we will continue with our breast month, let's say, presentation. Dr. Achra will continue talking to us about the breast MRI from basic to advanced. Today we'll talk, she'll start with the part two of the presentation. Last week she talked about the dynamic curves and the positioning and the basic sequences that we need, and today she will continue.
Good morning, everyone. Today we will continue our seminar on breast MRI, starting from where we stopped last week, which was the indication of the breast MRI. Indications of the breast MRI. There are many indications of the breast MRI. Let's take a quick look on the indications of the breast MRI. First, screening, which is adjunct to the mammogram, an evaluation of extent of the disease, evaluation of the treatment response in neoadjuvant population, and axillary or distal metastasis with unknown primary, and screening of contralateral breast in newly diagnosed breast cancer. Post-lumpectomy with a positive margin, recurrence of breast cancer, patients with breast augmentation in which the mammography is difficult for them, and MRI-guided biopsy. A few notes here that apart from the screening, which adjunct to the mammography, the other all is the further discrimination and characterization of the breast lesions that have been diagnosed by the other modality, I mean the ultrasound and the mammogram. So here, why it's important to know the indications of the breast MRI? Because according to the indication, we will use certain types of protocol. What I mean, as I told you in the last week, that protocols, there are two types of the protocol, the abbreviated one and a multi-parametric breast MRI protocol. The abbreviated one always using for the screening of the patient, which including the T1 weighted acquisitions pre and post contrast, while the multi-parametric breast MRI protocol, as I told you before, including the T2 weighted image, usually weighted image followed by the ADC, and the T1 weighted image pre contrast. And after contrast administration, there will be an ultra fast and series of the T1 weighted image. And this is for the evaluations of the dynamic motions of the contrast in the lesion. So, screening. For the screening by the breast MRI is just like a screening by the mammogram. What I mean is that you can do the screening with the breast MRI simultaneously with the mammogram or with a 6-month interval with the mammogram. And for the screening, we have to divide the patients into three groups, just like the mammography. For example, the high-risk population, intermediate-risk population, and the average-risk population, which they call them the asymptomatic patient. About the high-risk population, are those patients who have risk for developing the breast cancer in their lifetime above 20%, and the intermediate risk patients are those patients who have risk for developing the breast cancer in their lifetime about 50 to 20%, and the average risk patients or asymptomatic risk patients, there is no recommendations for the breast MRI at all.
So the screening MRI is done with mammogram or
yes,
within 6 months?
Yes, you can do it simultaneously or with interval of 6 months.
And is the screening mammogram MRI is done also with contrast?
I would tell you, yeah. No, the abbreviated protocol uses for the screening by the breast MRI. Abbreviated one, it means that T1 weighted pre and post contrast. That's it. There's
so
no
screening,
need for the other.
Okay, but also with contrast?
Yes, with both.
Yes.
For the woman, which regarding them as a high risk patient, who are those women? Are those women who did the test for the BRCA1 and BRCA2 gene mutations and the results is positive? Or they are a first degree relative for those patients who have a positive BRCA1 test gene mutation? The history or For those patients who have the history of the chest wall radiation aging from 10 to 30 years in their lifetime. About the intermediate risk patient, the intermediate risk patient are those patients who have history of the breast cancer plus have dense breast tissue or diagnosed under the age of 15 years. About the personal history of the breast cancer, or they have the breast cancer that have been diagnosed in intermediate risk patients are lobular carcinoma in situ and adenoductal atypical ductal hyperplasia or atypical lobular hyperplasia. Considering MRI, especially if the other risk factors are present. For the average risk patients, not recommended to do the MRI. About the screening plans for the breast MRI, just like that all the mammography. So I will just talk a little bit briefly about it. Okay, what's important here to know that for screening of the breast MRI, it's better to choose the imaging time between 15 to 14 days of the cycle. Why? Because the MRI results depending on
five
the hormone, 5 to 14, yes, because the MRI result depending on the hormonal change in the body, especially in the luteal phase. I will tell you why. In the next slide here, as you see, in the first image on the right side, you will see that there is an enhancing lesion. You can regard it as an occult lesion that is clearly financed by the MRI. In the next image, which has been taken after 2 weeks, there will be no such occult lesion seen. And this means that this is due to the hormonal effect of this lesion appearing. So it's better to do the screening for the breast MRI in between 5 to 14 days of the cycle. About the screening planning, it's important to know which type of the patient is the high risk or the medium risk or the average risk. Because for the high risk patient, I was starting from the bottom to the up, the high risk patient needs to do yearly, once a time, to do the breast MRI simultaneously with the mammogram or with the interval of 6 months, yearly from 40 to 69 years, and later on, every 2 years, have to do the breast MRI. The intermediate risk patients, for them, in between 14 and 49 years, yearly have to do the breast MRI or the mammogram. If there is anything that appears to be positive, later on further investigation and management steps will be taken. And in between 50 and 69 years, screening every year with the mammogram, also with the MRI of the breast. And about the average one, for the average one, in between 40 to 49 years, no regular screening needs, even by the mammogram, but between 50 and 69 years should be screened every 2 years one time. Next slide, please. So, why we are doing the breast MRI simultaneously with the mammogram? As you see here, there's three curves. The middle one is the mammogram results of a breast lesion. That is suspicious lesion, it has to say. By the MRI, we can divide it more, the results of the investigation of such lesion, into a normal, maybe normal benign, you can get these results just by the MRI. Or maybe suspicious and cancer further investigation, like a biopsy, should be taken when you take these results by the MRI. So it's important to do the MRI for every single breast lesions diagnosed by the other modality, I mean by the ultrasound or the mammogram. So other indications, for the breast MRI, as I told you, apart from the screening, is the further discrimination and characterization of the breast lesion. So it's to know why it's important to do further discrimination and characterization. tell you why. First of all, let's think a little bit emotionally about the psychology and the moods of the patients who has been diagnosed newly as having a CA breast. The patient will think about the shape of her breast, first of all, in the future, and also the circumference after diagnosing as a CA breast. So all the questions that the patients have in her mind will be answered by the good management for this breast lesion. And the good management and good results of management will depend totally on what, on the surgeon's decisions to do, which types of the surgery for such a lesion. And the exact and the good decisions from the surgeon to do the surgery for the lesion is depend totally on a best or full characterization of the breast lesion, which is our role as a radiologist. And this is only be done by the MRI of the breast. You can do it with the other modality perfectly, but by the MRI you can do it. I will tell you why with examples. So here, the discrimination of the lesion, according to the lesion's time for of the diagnosis, I will show you the further discrimination needed for which breast lesion. First, evaluation of the extent of the diseases. Putting in your mind that the surgeon do the operation for such a patient without doing a breast MRI, just depending on the what? On the ultrasound and the mammogram. Here, you will find out by the MRI that there is an occult lesion in the pectoralis region. That's very, very difficult to be diagnosed by the mammogram. So that's why the pectoralis muscle invasion or multifocality or multicentricity of the lesion can be done only by the breast MRI. This is the important. Next. And here in this lesion, maybe this is a multifocality lesion. Maybe just one or two of these lesions being seen by the other modality, by the breast MRI, you'll find out that this is a multifocality. According to this results that have appears by the breast MRI, the surgeon should do total mastectomy, not only lobectomy or lumpectomy for this lesion. And the important things about the breast MRI is that the follow-up of a new adjuvant population. What does I mean? That you know the first lines of the management for the patients who have been diagnosed as a CA breast, the first line is the new adjuvant chemotherapy. And after that, to find out how response will be, then the surgeon's planning coming later on after the new adjuvant treatment. Here's the treatment response. The patients take an MRI image from 23rd July 2018, and you find out that there is an enhancing lesion, two enhancing lesions in the breast. After new adjuvant chemotherapy have been taken in the next November 2018, you will find that there is a good response of the lesion to the new adjuvant chemotherapy. So that means a further step for the removing or managing this such a lesions, no needs anymore, just a follow-up. This is a great thing, and fortunately this patient is quite lucky. And also the axillary metastasis with unknown primary, for example, patients have an axillary metastasis but with unknown primary lesion, by the MRI you will find out that there is an occult lesion in the ipsilateral breast that's very small, cannot be seen by the other modality as is shown here by in this picture. Another indication, the occult diseases in contralateral breast is very important. Not only treating the breast that have been diagnosed as a CA breast, it's better to evaluate and make a good screening for the contralateral breast, and in order to exclude that there is an occult lesion that can be seen by the other modality. An occult disease in ipsilateral rectus, abdominis, mucocutaneous, plastic constructions of the breast after the diagnosing the CV breast as shown in this picture, you will find out after reconstructions of the breast, there is a breast lesion or a malignant lesion find out in the pectoralis region, means in the transverse rectus abdominis mucocutaneous flap site. So, for the follow-up of such patient, better to do the breast MRI than the other adults. Next slide. Here, showing fat necrosis. The fat necrosis, if you look at the mammogram, and in the next two image showing the fat necrosis with the MRI image, here you will find out in a T2 weighted image, and the left side is the T2 weighted image, yeah. And this one is the maximum intensity projection. You find out this is only a fat necrosis, it's not a lesion or suspicious lesions to be worried about it. So it's important to do the breast MRI to figure out or more characterization of the breast lesions to be clearly for you. Also, another thing which is very important to do it, free silicone or paraffin injection for breast reconstruction after CA breast mastectomy. It's important to do the breast MRI than the mammogram. Even the mammogram can be done for this patient for the free silicone or paraffin injection, but the breast implant, no.
Just to comment, first of all, the free silicone injection is not something that's done after mastectomy.
Yes.
It's an old way of doing breast augmentation. In the beginning, they started by injecting silicone just like that all over the breast. But however, as far as I know, now this is an obsolete thing. You don't see these patients now. Now it's just a bag of silicone and they implanted either pre-pectoral or post-pectoral, depending on the technique of the surgery. But these things here, thank God they stopped doing that free silicone injection, because this cannot be removed at all. And if it migrates, it's a big problem, and it's damaging to the mammography and the MRI, and it makes our life much more difficult.
Yes, but augmentation of the breast, better to do the breast MRI than the other modality.
Yes.
Next slide. Here's, as I told you before, because the MRI have higher sensitivity for the detections of the occult lesion and non-mask enhancing lesion, so the biopsy that's been asked for taking from these lesions, the MRI guided biopsy should be chosen. So here is showing that the MRI guiding biopsy, these are the lines as I showed you before, special equipment used during the mammography, and this is the needles, the next one. This is the targeting, and the other ones is the biopsy clips. And implant cancer, as Dr. Ahmed mentioned about it just before now, that for the breast implantation, as is shown here in this picture, it's better to do the follow-up by the breast MRI. Here, the implant cancer example, in which showing the occult lesion in the residual breast tissue just above the implanted silicone bag. Next slide, please. Here shows bilateral breast augmentation by the breast MRI. This is T2 weighted. And if you looking at the next slide, it will show you that there is a spread of the malignant lesions inside even of the silicone bag.
Sorry?
Inside the silicone bag. There's these spots, if you see it here, these are all the occult lesions that can be seen by the other modalities spreading into the silicone bag.
And malignant
lesions, invading.
the silicone?
Yes, inside the silicone. In the back of the silicone.
Yeah,
I mean,
surround.
And the surround.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Not
yes.
In the
silicone. No.
Sorry,
the surround of the silicone. That you can see the back of the silicone by the other modality, but here you can see it in the maximum.
So the breast tissue surrounding the silicone,
yes.
Behind anterior and posterior to it, and on the sides, all contains malignant
cells. Breast MR report structures. For the breast MRI report structures, we need to write down the clinical history and comparison to the old study. Acquisition parameter, it means which acquisition you use it, this patient. Sequences, fold strength, contrast agent, dose, post-processing, subtractions, and maximum intensity projection. A findings impression at the end of the report. For the breast anatomy, briefly, it's composed of two tissues, fat tissue and fibroglandular tissue. And the fibroglandular tissue is composed of two systems, lobular and ductal. Briefly. So when there is a CA breast, it's either coming from the ductal system or it's coming from the lobular system. Breast consists mainly of the glandular tissue and the latest one changing with the age in response to the female's hormone. It extends from the second to the sixth rib and entirely overlying by the chest wall, overlining the chest wall fascia, which forms the septa called Cooper suspensory ligaments, supporting the breast from pectoralis muscles fascia to the skin. Here, showing breast anatomy, which composed nearly about 15 to 20 lobes, every lobe is dividing into more lobules. Number of the lobules with the age, I mean in the reproductive ages, will be increased sometime to reach into the more than 100 even. Lobules contain acini and draining ducts, and interlobular connective tissue. By teenage years, may reach to the hundreds of the lobules. In a breast profile here shown ducts, lobules, dilated sections of the duct to hold the milk, and nipple, fat, pectoralis major muscle, chest wall, rib cage. The enlargement of the breast is occurred with the normal duct cells and basement membranes and the lumen, center of the duct. All these things will lead to the enlargement of the breast, especially in a pregnant woman or nursery. What's the breast cancer? 90% of the breast cancer is coming from the duct, and 10% of the cancer is coming from the lobule cells. And these are a very different cancer that are both called the breast cancer. So breast cancer starts when a ductal or the lobular cells began to grow abnormally. Because normally, growth of these cells are normal according to the response of the body to the hormones. But abnormal growth leads into the formation of the breast cancer. Finding. The finding that you will have to pay attention during the breast MRI is that you have to mention the amount of the fibroglandular tissue in the breast. Number two, you have to note or pay attention for the background parenchymal enhancement, which is different from the amount of the fibroglandular tissue, and abnormal enhancement, whether it's focus or it's mass, non-mass enhancing, and also the kinetic curve assessment. Associated features, non-enhancing finding. All these you have to pay attention during the breast MRI. Amount of the fibroglandular tissue. There are multiple classifications for the amount of the fibroglandular tissue. The Wolf classification, in which classifying the amount of the fibroglandular tissue into N1, which is almost always is fatty, and P1, which is scattered fibroglandular tissue, and P2, which is heterogeneous fibroglandular tissue, and DY, it is dense tissue. Tabor classification, Boyd classification, and ACR classification. The ACR classification is a modified Wolf classification, which classifying the fibro, the amount of fibroglandular tissue into 1, 2, 3, 4. Overall breast composition is almost entirely fat, scattered fibroglandular tissue, heterogeneous fibroglandular tissue, and extreme fibroglandular tissue, or what we call dense breast. Here is it. The first one on the right side is the almost entirely fatty. And the second is scattered fibroglandular tissue, and the other one is heterogeneous. The last one is the dense or extreme fibroglandular tissue. This is very important to pay attention about it. Is the background parenchymal enhancement. What does that mean? The background parenchymal enhancement is the percent of the enhancement of the fibroglandular tissue. That's what we determine on the fibroglandular tissue. Assessment occur on the first post-contrast image, usually 97. As I told you before, the image that should be taken within 97 or 60 seconds after contrast administration, you have to pay attention to the background parenchymal enhancement, which is the percent of enhancing the fibroglandular tissue. And this is dividing the breast into the minimal, mild, moderate, marked. It's not depending on the types of the fibroglandular tissue, which is type 1, 2, 3, 4. No, it's totally different. Maybe this one, marked, and the fibroglandular tissue may be 2 or 3. So there is no correlation between them. Here's a background enhancement at the MRI. As you show here, the first one on the right side is the minimal, and the second one is the mild. The third one button on the right side is the moderate, and the other one is marked background parenchymal enhancement.
What is the significance of this?
It's important. I will tell you later on the next few slides. Background parenchymal enhancement is not equal to the dense, as I told you. And they are not the same. Patients can have a dense breast, but minimal background parenchymal enhancement. So you have to put in your mind that the background parenchymal enhancement with the hormonal replacement therapy, or with the patients who are in the last 2 weeks of the menstrual period, they have a high background parenchymal enhancement. But those patients who are on tamoxifen, which is a chemotherapy taken with the patients with CA breast, so they have hormonal that taken with the CA breast, have low background parenchymal enhancement. Background parenchymal enhancement in general, more prominent in a luteal phase, as I told you, because depending on the hormonal level of the cycle in premenstrual women. If screening recommended image, as I told you, is better to done in the next, in the second week of the menstrual cycle. If cancer diagnosed, perform at any time. There's no need to precise the time of doing the breast MRI. Here's the background parenchymal enhancement, how you are mentioning it, whether it is symmetrical or it is asymmetrical. Symmetrical, as is it on the right image showing, it's more going to be a benign. Asymmetrical may be benign or malignant, as it's here. This is asymmetrical background parenchymal enhancement. Maybe a question coming into your mind about background parenchymal enhancement present simultaneously with the breast lesion. So here in this time, the maximum intensity projection will figure out the lesion and subside the enhancement of the background parenchyma. Yes. Yes. Should prompt review of a clinical history, mammogram, and ultrasound finding, a positive predictive value for the malignancy is about 14% in this patient we have. Asymmetrical background parenchymal enhancement, benign causes, prior to the radiotherapy, radiated breast has less background parenchymal enhancement. Those patients who are taking the radiotherapy, they have a little bit less background parenchymal enhancement, and also the mastitis also have less.
Yes.
I think for today.
Still today? Okay. Thank you. Amazing. Excellent. I love it. Really, really nice, good